Hello, good morning. It's 8 o'clock on Saturday, the 30th of July. I'm at St. Mary's Halesworth. Welcome to morning prayer. If you are wanting to follow in the book, you'll find the words towards the beginning, after prayer during the day. And you'll need to find morning prayer on Saturday in the ordinary time section. Online, you can find the words at the Church of England's website or Remus Daily Prayer or downloadables apps for Apple or Android devices. Going back to the book, it's also the Lesser Festival on the 30th of July of William Wilberforce and other anti-slavery campaigners. If you want to be ready to pick up on any minor adjustments to our running order to what you've got on ordinary morning prayer on Saturday, you might like to look up amongst the Saints' Days and Festivals halfway through the book, 30th of July, to find that additional material. I'm recording the audio to upload onto my Dominic Doble YouTube channel. The codes for the Zoom meeting that I set up every time I'm in are available on the Blythe Church's website and Facebook page. I'm live streaming on Facebook, and those of you who can see or hear may be able to tell that I'm actually in the building. And you're very welcome to join me here 8 and 6 every day. My colleague is in on Monday. We have traditional communion and said evensong with hymns on Sundays usually, but this being a fifth Sunday, on this occasion we're just having a 10 o'clock service at Linstead. You're very welcome to join us there. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Moving on to a song of God's praise. O God, you are my God, eagerly I seek you. My soul is athirst for you, my flesh also faints for you, as in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. So would I gaze upon you in your holy place, that I might behold your power and your glory. Your loving kindness is better than life itself, and so my lips shall praise you. I will bless you as long as I live, and lift up my hands in your name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips. When I remember you upon my bed, and meditate on you in the watches of the night. For you have been my helper, and under the shadow of your wings will I rejoice. My soul clings to you, your right hand shall hold me fast. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. The night has passed and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. We now turn to the back of the book, or scroll on, to the appointed psalmody for the day. And today's appointed psalm is number 147, 147. I'll read it straight through. You're welcome to read the even-numbered verses, as well as the refrain, the glory be, if you will. And we'll pause to use the prayer that follows as we see fit. Psalm 147. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. Alleluia, how good it is to make music for our God. How joyful to honour him with praise. The Lord builds up Jerusalem and gathers together the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up all their wounds. He counts the number of the stars, calls them all by their names. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His wisdom is beyond all telling. The Lord lifts up the poor, but casts down the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God upon the lyre, who covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth, who makes grass to grow upon the mountains and green plants to serve our needs. He gives the beasts their food, the young ravens when they cry. He takes no pleasure in the power of a horse, no delight in human strength. But the Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their trust in his steadfast love. Sing praise to the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion. For he has strengthened the bars of your gates and has blessed your children within you. He has established peace in your borders and satisfies you with the finest wheat. He sends forth his command to the earth, and his word runs very swiftly. He gives snow like wool and scatters the hoarfrost like ashes. He casts down his hailstones like morsels of bread. Who can endure his frost? He sends forth his word and melts them. He blows with his wind and the waters flow. He declares his word to Jacob, his statutes and judgments to Israel. He has not dealt so with any other nation. They do not know his laws. Alleluia. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Great is our Lord, and mighty in power. Scrolling past our first reading to the Song of Jerusalem, our Mother, or turning back to morning prayer on Saturday in ordinary time, if we're following in the book. Thus says our God, I will comfort you. You shall see and your heart shall rejoice. Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her, says the Lord. Rejoice with her in joy, all you who mourn over her, that you may drink deeply with delight from her consoling breast. For thus says our God, you shall be nursed and carried on her arm. As a mother comforts her children, so I will comfort you. You shall see and your heart shall rejoice. You shall flourish like the grass of the fields. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Thus says our God, I will comfort you. You shall see and your heart shall rejoice. From Kindle edition of Celebrating the Saints. William Wilberforce was born in 1759 in Hull. Converted to an evangelical piety within the Church of England, Wilberforce decided to serve the faith in Parliament instead of being ordained. Becoming a member of Parliament at the age of 21, he was a supporter of missionary initiatives and helped found the Bible Society. Settling in Clapham in London, he became a leader of the reforming group of evangelicals known as the Clapham Sect. Of all the causes for which he fought, he is remembered best for his crusade against slavery. After years of effort, the trade in slaves was made illegal in the British Empire in 1807, and Wilberforce lived to see the complete abolition of slavery just before his death on this day in the year 1833. So to our first Bible reading, 1 Samuel 9 from 15 to the first verse in the following chapter. Samuel, the two books of Samuel are in the history section of Hebrew Scriptures, so if you're taking a book off the shelf, after the first five following Genesis, four following Genesis, the first five books of the law, you come to the history section, opening with Joshua, and then after Judges, I think you'll find you've got a couple of books named after the prophet Samuel. And we're looking for the first book of Samuel. We're looking for the large number 9 at the head of the paragraph, chapter 9, and we're starting at little numbers in the text, the verse 15, 1 Samuel 9 from 15. Now the day before Samuel came, the Lord had revealed to Samuel, tomorrow about this time I will send to you a man from the land of Benjamin, and you shall anoint him to be ruler over my people Israel. He shall save my people from the hand of the Philistines, for I have seen the suffering of my people, because their outcry has come to me. When Samuel saw Saul, the Lord told him, here is the man of whom I spoke to you. Here it is who shall rule over my people. Then Saul approached Samuel inside the gate and said, tell me, please, where is the house of the seer? Samuel answered Saul, I am the seer. Go up before me to the shrine, for today you shall eat with me, and in the morning I will let you go. And will tell you all that is on your mind. As for your donkeys that were lost 3 days ago, have give no further thought to them. They have been found, and on whom is all Israel's desire fixed, if not on you, and on all your ancestral house? Saul answered, I am only a Benjaminite from the least of the tribes of Israel, and my family is the humblest of the families of the tribe of Benjamin. Why then have you spoken to you in this way? And Samuel took Saul and his servant boy and brought them into the hall and gave them a place at the head of those who had been invited, of whom there were about 30. Samuel said to the cook, bring the portion I gave you, the one I asked you to put aside. The cook took up the thigh and that and what went with it, and set them before Saul. Samuel said, see, what was kept is set before you. Eat, for it is set before you at the appointed time, so that you might eat with the guests. So Saul ate with Samuel that day, and when they came down from the shrine into the town, a bed was spread for Saul on the roof, and he lay down to sleep. Then at the break of dawn, Samuel called to Saul upon the roof, get up, that I may send you on your way. Saul got up, and both he and Samuel went out on the street. As they were going down into the outskirts of the town, Samuel said to Saul, "Tell the boy to go on before us, and when he's passed on, stop here yourself for a while, that I may make known to you the word of God." Samuel took a phial of oil and poured it on his head and kissed him. He said, "The Lord has anointed you ruler over his people Israel. You shall reign over the people of the Lord, and you will save them from the hand of their enemies all around. Now this shall be the sign to you that the Lord has anointed you ruler over his heritage." And then the reading stops. I can come back same time, same place tomorrow. Well, actually, we're not going to be reading the next reading tomorrow morning. But if you've got your Bibles open, you can take a sneaky peek at what it is that is the sign. But we have Saul here, who's just been sent by his dad on a fairly standard mission to find some lost donkeys. And they're just about to turn around, him and the servant lads, and they decide Saul is all for turning around, but the lad says, "Go on." And because he reckons they could ask of this prophet where the donkeys are, they arrive. God's already told Samuel that there's this person coming who's a Benjaminite and that he's to anoint this lad with as king. So Saul is wanting to know about donkeys, and in the end, he is anointed king in this extraordinarily private ceremony just by the roadside, just the prophet and Saul. It's just extraordinary calling, and we may feel almost as unprepared. We might just have been out, not necessarily looking for donkeys, but I don't know, looking for somewhere to live or finding a holiday or buying a pair of shoes. And suddenly, all of a sudden, we might have a prophet turn up and anoint as king, but it might just become clear that we have that responsibility, that relationship, that job, that house is the right one. It will fall into place. And we might feel entirely inadequate, underfunded, without enough training or coaching. We might find we're pregnant, who knows. All of those things. Here we have a story of somebody who's suddenly become a ruler over a people, and they were only looking for donkeys. Be prepared, be ready. God moves in mysterious ways. I'd be great fun to do a film of that, because as I said, he's just a farmer's son looking for a couple of lost sheep, and he suddenly turns up in sort of high society and he's given this thigh. You can imagine this great thing, looking back to some of our sort of medieval kings and how they would just eat with tables laden with 20 plus swans and peacocks and goodness knows what else, pigs. And this lad, who might have only been used to having a little bit of bread and cheese, suddenly given this most impressive, vast heap of the best bit of the animal to eat. And his little face widening with fear, awe, wonder, excitement. So to our next reading, Luke 22 from 14. The Gospel of Luke is the third of the Gospels that open the Greek scripture, the Second Covenant. So if you're following your Bible and it doesn't have an Apocrypha, it's about two-thirds of the way through. If it does have an Apocrypha, it's slightly further on towards the end. So the last portion of the Bible, most of which is the Hebrew scriptures, of course. If you open it about there, and you should find Matthew, Mark, then Luke. Looking for chapter 22, large number 22, small numbers in the text, the verse of 14. Luke 22 from 14 to 23. When the hour came, he took his place at the table and the apostles with him. He said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves, for I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But see, the one who betrays me is with me, and his hand is on the table. For the Son of Man is going as it has been determined. But woe to that one by whom he is betrayed." Then they began to ask one another which one of them it could be who would do this. Luke's account of the Last Supper, the Passover meal, and some of these liturgical words that have been put in. Excuse me, my phone's just popped out of its holder, so I've scooted off to one side for those watching on Facebook. So yeah, Luke's account of the Last Supper, Passover, and there are some elements of it that we might recognise from other accounts in Scripture. Some things, excuse me, slightly different. There seems to be excuse me, a focus in the first, saying he's taken the cup and taken the bread. It's almost as if there's preparatory prayers before he comes to actually doing the blessing of the bread and the cup. And he says, eat this and I won't share it again until all is fulfilled. The rule of God is fulfilled. Does he mean he's going to die afterwards? Does he mean when all believers have this mystical fulfillment of the Holy Communion with God in paradise at the end of all time, that great marriage supper of the Lamb, that mythical, mystical concept of togetherness to which we all strive, for which we all strive, those of us that believe, however we understand it. So there's very much a, we're doing this now as a promise, as an expression of what we believe will happen in the future. It's a particular emphasis from Luke, and then the more familiar, this is my body given for you, and the cup is poured out for you. It's the new covenant in my blood. Interesting, doesn't say this is my blood. He says it's the covenant secured in my blood. And then immediately we're told that there is a betrayer who is sharing a meal. And that too is very interesting. How careful are we about only allowing certain people to eat and drink? Do we have an open table? And my own view is that I am happy for all to receive. I've had people tell me that they don't consider me to be worthy of my calling, and yet they would still receive Holy Communion from me. Maybe they understood that God's grace was sufficient. I'm inclined to entirely agree with them, but it's a bit odd if somebody doesn't really think that somebody is up to it, that they're still prepared to honour that role and function by receiving from somebody who holds it. But we must be prepared, I guess, to work out how we deal with those who are treacherous. We need to look after ourselves, those amongst whom we live, thinking about safeguarding. We mustn't allow situations that are likely to deteriorate or cause hurt to take place, either to the perpetrator or to their targets, even if that target is ourselves. So to the responsory back in morning prayer on Saturday. Your salvation is near to those who fear you, that glory may dwell in our land. Your salvation is near to those who fear you, that glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. That glory may dwell in our land. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Your salvation is near to those who fear you, that glory may dwell in our land. The Benedictus. The opening refrain is not the standard one for a Saturday morning, I think. So if you are following in the book, you either just join with us at Blessed Be, or you might like to look up today's date. What was it, the 30th amongst the saints' days and festivals, to find direction to the, I don't know what it would be, common of saints. I don't think Wilberforce was martyred, but there'd be direction there at any rate to the refrain with which we open and close the Song of Zechariah. They were faithful unto death, and God has given them the crown of life. Blessed be the Lord, God of Israel. He has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Saviour, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets, God promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors, to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath God swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight all the days of our life. And you, child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of all their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. They were faithful unto death, and God has given them the crown of life. Let us pray. Source of the Sabbath, heir of peace, comforter, advocate, three in one, one in three. As we begin this day of rest, we pray that you will make it one for us, that it will be a peaceable day, a day where we are without stress or anxiety or fear, where we will be able to rest in God's provision, protection and presence. We pray that we will be supported by others, whether it's counselling, whether it's bankers, family, neighbours, local authorities, social services, the NHS, adequately to help us cope with the circumstances of the day. We pray for those in other agencies, voluntary charities that seek to bring peace where there is no peace. Pray especially for the people of Ukraine, Palestine, Israel, Myanmar, Hong Kong. These and all parts of the world where ethnicities, tribes, religions, political views collide with violence and so destroy innocent people and creation, wildlife. It is all just so bleak. We pray for all who seek to bring hope and peace and rest, provision, safety, security, sanctuary in all those circumstances. There is injustice in law, at home and abroad. From Operation World, we pray for Kazakhstan. The expatriate community is diverse. We thank God for the coordinating work of the Kazakh Partnership. Christian Mercy Ministries, we pray for Christians to have a powerful transforming effect on society as they demonstrate Christ's love. From Christian Action Research and Education, we ask God to enable Christians engaged in helping victims and survivors of modern slavery to demonstrate excellent professional skills and knowledge that is inspired and empowered by God's love for every individual who has been so cruelly abused. From Green Christian across the world, lakes fed by rivers, glacial melt, groundwater and rain have played an important role in human civilization development. They contain 90% of the fresh water on the planet's surface, house an array of wildlife, and make possible farming, fishing and industry. Yet, due to climate change, pollution, mining, population pressure and unsustainable land use, they are declining at an unprecedented rate. Freshwater ecosystems have lost more extent and biodiversity than almost any ecosystem in the world. The threats facing lakes are interlinked. Lake pollution is worsened by global heating, leading, for instance, to more frequent and intense floods, cause nutrient surface-bound contaminants and solid waste to be flushed into rivers and lakes. Water pollution has continued to worsen over the last two decades, increasing the threats to freshwater ecosystems and human health, says the United Nations, I think that's Environment Partnerships, report Making Peace with Nature, published last year. We pray, God, that all have the power to influence the way water is used and cared for. We'll use that power. And we as consumers can choose where we spend. We can choose how informed we are. We can choose as voters who we vote for. There's been a long-running campaign to try and cause our government to prevent water companies from polluting rivers. And water companies, as part of that sort of, I was going to say cartel might be the right word, of high-powered global investors who actually could spend a few extra quid preventing sewage from going back into rivers, would rather just keep the dividends for themselves. So we pray that God will be merciful in our benefit. Cycle of prayer on Saturdays. We pray for our elected representatives. We pray for the Conservative Party as they choose our new Prime Minister. We pray for the Labour Party as it sorts itself out. And all those who may feel they need to establish another party that is more traditionally Labour. We pray for Greens. Locally, we pray for those in our town council that be encouraged and inspired to be ambitious, to be people of hope and vision, recognising the relative lack of power, especially as they don't have control over land that was supposed to be being passed to them by the district, continuing to suffer the hurt and pain of losing the middle school. And we pray for our district and county council that there will be a collaborative, collegiate spirit that will benefit all people in this part of Suffolk. And we pray for our ministers across these 14. Janet, Eileen, John, Malcolm, Robert, Alison, Jason, Margaret. Excuse me, as elders. Although I think Margaret stepped down, so maybe we shouldn't be praying for her anymore. At least not as an elder. We pray for our reader, Diana. Jonathan, Anna, David, Vic. Alison as associate priests. Linda as a curate. Ginny, team vicar, and me as team rector. We thank you for our callings and your directing of us to be the people we are, to serve your people where they are. We pray that you continue to bless and grow relationship, respect, understanding of each other, and the mission and ministry that you express through our bishops Martin and Michael in this place. And we pray that you will grow your church as we grow in understanding, experience, as we grow in number, and as we grow in influence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our deliverer, who sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to set your people free from the slavery of sin, grant that as your servants William Wilberforce, Alauda Aquiano, and Thomas Clarkson toiled against the sin of slavery, so we may bring compassion to all and work for the freedom of all the children of God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless us and preserve us from all evil and keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Goodbye to those joining us on Facebook and YouTube.